Without further ado, let me begin this conversation. Mr. Khan, thank you so much indeed for joining us as well. We're talking at a time when the growth in the economy has slowed for the last 5 quarters. 1 year ago, low oil prices, we were the fastest growing economy in the world. Things were looking great. Why are we here?
You know, when you carry structural changes in the economy, when you're trying to formalize your economy,
we may need the mic.
Yeah.
Please not.
We are wired.
Well, I just walked in, so you're carrying out some major structural reforms in your economy. You're trying to formalize your economy. You've brought in something which everybody was asking for, GST. I think Indians will have to learn the art of living with some teething issues of structural reforms. And I don't think it's a long-term decline in fortunes as such. I think we need to push for even greater reforms. And my personal view is that we'll be able to set this house perfectly in order. And I don't think we need to take a short-term perspective of this. I'm a great believer in fiscal discipline, and I'm a great believer that India needs to continue the process of structural reforms. I think we need to push for disinvestment in a much, much bigger way. In Niti Aayog, we've made a vast number of recommendations which we need to keep pushing for in terms of implementation. Actually, the public sector investment has more than made up for the lack of private sector investment in the last 6 months. But whatever government has created over the years needs to be put out into the market. Government is extremely poor in operation and maintenance, and therefore, we need to carry out a continuous process of reverse BOT, because these are projects which were risks have been totally eliminated. There are roads where tolls have already come in. There are airports which are well functional, and there's no need for government to run them. You need to completely put them out into the market. I'm also a believer that you need very major structural changes in areas of mining. I mean, India is a very undermined area, and there's huge possibility in terms of very major reforms, and it can be a very vast, it can be a sector which can greatly create jobs. And my personal view is that there's still a huge possibility of carrying out very many reforms which can push both growth and employment in the Indian economy. So I don't think we need to take a short-term perspective. We need to keep taking a longer-term perspective of continuously reviving the private sector investment. I'm not a believer that it's government which can create growth. It's private sector which has to create growth. And we need to keep creating opportunities for private sector to keep investing in the Indian economy.
Okay. Before we get to the point about private sector investments, Mr. Khan, you said you are a believer in fiscal discipline. The finance minister just a short while ago said stimulus is a word speculated by the media. And he used the word response. Is there a need to respond, and what could that response be?
So if you need to respond, you've got to be extremely careful that revenue expenditure, if you look at both the center and the state, and you know, while the center has been extremely disciplined in terms of sticking on to its fiscal targets of 3.2, the states also need to be extremely disciplined, because it's both center and state together in terms of the fiscal discipline. And it's important that we must realize that the government in totality, both center and state, when it pushes for increased allocations, for subsidies, for interest payments, for farm loans, waivers, it does immense damage to the Indian economy. And therefore, there's a need for huge, huge discipline as far as revenue expenditure is concerned. You still have a possibility if you're pushing, and my belief is that you need to push for quality of expenditure. It's not about expenditure. It's about the quality of expenditure. if you're pushing for expenditure on projects which are at very advanced stage where you can push for implementation on ground, if you're able to push for exports, if you're able to push for bank capitalization, these are issues which are a challenge for the finance minister. He's talked about discussing with the prime minister. I've just walked in, so I'm not aware. My flight was late, I didn't hear him out. Okay. But my view is that it's not about expenditure. Mm-hmm. It's about quality of expenditure, which will push the limits of growth of Indian economy.
Fair point. I'll come to exports in just a bit. Shankar, the point Mr. Kant is also making is that the private sector is not spending enough. And there are reasons for it. There is a large debt problem. There is insufficient capacity utilization. What's going to motivate you guys to go out and spend?
I think it's a bit of a complex problem. The private sector is in the current phase after investing heavily. And the finance minister did mention that the jury being out as to how much of that was indiscretion and how much was that was a calculated risk. Representing private sector and representing a firm which is dealing with investments, I would like to believe that India provided and now provides enormous opportunity. I think there's no debate about the opportunity India provides. It's just a question of how each company gears itself to utilize the opportunity. Some of the investments tend to be very asset heavy, and hence the load on the balance sheet becomes heavier than normal, and some of them are reasonably asset light. What the private sector is facing today is the pressure to generate returns on the investments that have been already made. While there could be a lot of reasons as to why we can't overload the balance sheet until corrections take place, it's going to be very important that each one of us have a roadmap for improving the return on equity so that we regain the investors' confidence. I'm not talking about the stock markets. They seem to be spinning in its own orbit. I'm just talking about the fundamentals, what the balance sheets show.
Sure.
So my sense is investments will follow minute the managements are confident that the return on investment will far exceed the cost of capital.
Okay. I'll come to the stock market in just a bit. Shanti, why don't you respond to this as a banker? The government is expecting the private sector to go ahead and spend at a time when consumption demand has been hit very badly. A, what's your reading of consumption demand? And, what can get these guys to spend?
Let me divide the investment into two parts from the private sector, as Shankar had said. One is the investment in infrastructure. The other in manufacturing. We talked about, defense, others, new sectors opening up, etc. You're not really seeing too much investment in either. I think the first part, as far as infrastructure was concerned, I think many people burnt their hands. Many have succeeded in setting up projects, but there is a large part that's stuck, and thus there is a lack of confidence. And Mr. Kant is absolutely right. Government has front-ended investments for the last 6 months, a large part in expenditure, which has really kept up the growth in a certain way. The second is really a private sector investment into manufacturing. The issue is there are surplus capacities today, and demand has not necessarily come anywhere close to utilizing the capacities. And normally you have a 3-year ahead investment cycle, which people are not seeing. You asked about consumption. Let me come to that. In fact, if you ask me what is holding up the economy today, is still consumption. Urban consumption, because of the aspirational value, which even the finance minister had alluded to, people still go out and spend money, whether it's on a home, whether it's on a car, whether it's on travel, whether it's on discretionary spends. It is there. Rural had taken a hit, but in the last 1.5 years, thanks to the monsoon, is coming back.
Right.
So if you ask me, yes, perhaps it may be muted if you compare it to the heydays, but there is still consumption happening. The issue is there is enough money in the system, but there is what I call the financialization of the economy. Money is really flowing into the financial sector, into markets and others, rather than into assets, real productive assets, right? And second is really that there is a shift from physical assets. So the issue really is, yes, private sector investments are not happening. It is not that people do not want to invest, but people have lost equity, have lost in projects, and are yet not seeing capacities being fully utilized. So what are they doing? They have to still generate earnings, right, for their stakeholders. So they are focusing on productivity. They are focusing on, how do you make things more efficient, which causes more problems on employment.
Okay. Rashesh, the point that Shankar was making, we are talking about whether the economy is going to rebound or not. The market seems to be on a different trajectory. We are talking about, we are near 10-year record highs. The headline on Bloomberg today was the bull market and a slowing economy. Is the market betting on a rebound in the economy, or is it just betting on short-term froth?
See, if you see the Indian economy for the last, I think, 4 or 5 years, actually 3 years especially, it has not been firing on all engines, but there are parts of the economy that have been doing well. And I think what happens to us is we all have a fairly schizophrenic kind of an existence where we sometimes see the glass half full, half empty. I think in the last couple of weeks, everybody started being concerned about growth. But if you look at it, I think in the last month, steel producers increased price by another 3,000 rupees. So we're saying steel is doing well. Cement is starting to come back. Housing also, especially affordable housing and all, is starting to do well. Auto is doing well. Financial services is doing reasonably well. So there are parts of the economy that have been doing well and continue to do well. There are other parts like exports and all, because of global issues and all, has been struggling. Parts of Indian manufacturing have been struggling because of, we are also interlinked with the global economy. If there's overcapacity outside, we get affected, especially as the rupee has got stronger. I think this ability to take risk also, I have been surprised in the last 5-6 months. I'm sure you would have also read a lot of these cases which have gone into NCLT.
Yes.
There are a lot of people interested in buying those assets, steel plants and cement plants and power plants. So the company's ability to invest money and acquire assets has been there. So my hypothesis is that I think people want to buy something that can produce returns quickly. So if you buy a steel plant which is working at 20% capacity utilization because it's an NPA, and you can take it up to 70-80% and get back your returns, I think people are interested in that because there are opportunities on that. Almost every good asset in NCLT, there are three, four potential buyers now. What people are hesitant to do is take a long greenfield 4-5 year kind of a view, because execution on greenfield projects in India, people have struggled with that. And especially, acquiring land and clearances and all that. So, and you also want good investors for that. So I think there is interest in the economy. There are parts of, like currently paper is doing well. So there are parts of the economy that continue to do well. We think there's a big opportunity in affordable housing.
Sure.
There's a big opportunity in electronic assembly and manufacturing. So there are opportunities, but I think currently we seem to get very bogged down by the parts of the economy that are slowing down.
Okay. Fair point. Mr. Khan, let me shift focus now to talk about exports. This is the investment side of the story, and we've heard everyone talk about it. On the export side, which many people have argued has been the key reason why you're seeing the slowdown across a couple of quarters, as Niti Aayog, as the head of the top policy-making body in this country, what is your policy prescription to get exports out of this funk?
Well, firstly, I'd just like to respond to the point Mr. Shah was making, and I think... To my mind, the government must push for projects which have been where revenue streams are well assured and which are fairly de-risked, and where it's possible to bring in private sector pretty early. There's no rationale of government running and operating national highways which have already been completed. They should be put outside into the market, and you'll have private sector operators coming in. There's no rationale at all for government to be running airports. I mean, why should a series of airports in tier cities be run by the Airport Authority of India? Put them out into the market. You'll have better operation and maintenance. I was in Ahmedabad recently on a new airport, water leaking, bathrooms badly maintained. Put them out into the market. You'll have private sector investment coming in. Why should the strategic disinvestment not be pushed far more rapidly. We need to push it far more aggressively. And we've done a huge amount of recommendation from Niti Aayog, and I think we'll work in partnership with the government to push for it with even greater vigor and energy. And all this has the possibility of bringing in a lot of private sector investment and reviving the animal spirits.
Sure.
That's important. Secondly, I don't think any country in the world has ever grown for long periods of time. I mean, historically, whether it was Japan, whether it was Korea, whether it was China, no country in the world has for long periods of time ever grown without penetrating global markets. And therefore, you know, many Indians keep talking about domestic market, you know, domestic market. We must, first of all, as Indians must understand that we have a large domestic market, but the export markets give you 10x of what you get in the domestic market. So Indians must start thinking in terms of size and scale. The problem with our export is that our manufacturing is very minuscule. Our manufacturing, Indians never grow out of being small or medium. You know, unless and until you don't start thinking of large in size and scale, it'll be very difficult for India to grow over a three-decade period.
Okay.
Until you don't penetrate markets. And this requires several things to be done. Our logistics must become far more efficient. I mean, we've created a huge monopoly out of the inland container corporation, you know, the railways container corporation. Why not put it out into the market? Put all these depots out into the market, you'll get private sector investment. Where is the risk? The government must push this, many of these ready-made infrastructure out into the market if you want private sector investment. You want investments? These are a whole range of projects which are being managed inefficiently by the public sector. Put them out into the market, you'll have a huge flow of private sector investment in, you'll bring in efficiency, you'll bring in better operation and maintenance. But let me tell you, till India's exports don't grow rapidly, till we don't penetrate markets, and it's not on the basis of subsidies. I'm talking about the competitiveness of exports. And competitiveness of export means that you must manufacture to size and scale.
Okay, on that point, Mr. Khan, exports is also extremely linked to where the currency is, and this is the right point for me to bring the pigeonhole question of the day. If you want to participate in it, please log on to pigeonhole.at with the passcode BBGIN. And the question that we are asking is, do you expect the Indian currency, the rupee, to strengthen in first quarter and second quarter of 2018? Rashesh, INR was the best performing currency in the first half of 2017. Now suddenly you've seen this turnaround. You're seeing a turnaround when there is capital outflows, widening CAD. How do you see the rupee behaving here on? Because that's a you know, key variable in export competitiveness that Mr. Kant is talking about.
Yeah, actually it's been a very, you know, I think even now there are a lot of people in this country who believe that a strengthening currency is a sign of strength. It's a, you know, it's a great thing to be proud about. But all over the world we are seeing, I think your competitiveness, India still has inflation. We have, you know, 3-4% inflation. So we do need a currency that is competitive. But while our CAD has been widening in the second quarter, we are seeing some phenomenal FDI flows. Even today when the bonds were auctioned off, there's a huge amount of demand in the bond market. So the portfolio flows are more than offsetting the current account deficit. It can't continue for a long time because ultimately I think you have to earn also. But I think India can manage a 2-3% current account deficit, which are offset by the portfolio flows. But I do hope that the rupee continues to weaken. And I think the fair price of the rupee should be 70-72, at which a lot of our steel companies, a lot of our other exporters are, it's not just exporters, it's also the what I call the tradables industries in India, like steel. Steel will get a huge fillip at 70-72 rupees, because then they can compete with the Chinese imports and all. So I do think the rupee needs to weaken, but I think the portfolio flows will somewhere act as a cap. But I do hope that this current trend with, you know, that has started, we should see about 66, 67 soon.
Okay, let me shift the conversation now to the second pillar of this topic, bank cleanups. Shanti, you may want to comment on this. The Reserve Bank of India and the government have taken a bunch of measures to clean up the system of NPAs. Is the framework working to your mind? How long do you think this is going to take for a resolution?
So I'll take a leaf out of what the finance minister said. I think at a policy level, this was absolutely the right thing to do, because you saw for a long time that the SARFAESI, there were issues in resolving large NPAs in the system. So this whole system of NCLT and referring cases from a policy level is absolutely right. But we must give it time. You know, there is a time frame that has been rolled out by which time, you know, resolutions have to happen. You have the IBP framework where you have people who will resolve. And so I think we have to give it time to see how it resolves. Given the policy, and if we actually see it operate within the timelines, it will have far-reaching impact on the banking system. I think it's early days yet. I think it's extremely critical that it gets resolved. And I think everybody, all the stakeholders are working towards it, but we will have to wait and watch how it flows out.
I'm going to get Mr. Kant to respond to that, but just before that, I want to ask the same question to the audience. Do you think enough is being done to address the issue of NPAs of banks, if you can bring up the pigeonhole question and get a sense of what you're thinking in the audience? Mr. Kant, why don't you respond to that as well?
You know, we don't have...
Actually, if I can just interrupt you, an overwhelming majority believe that not enough is being done. Am I getting that right?
Yeah.
It's changing. Yeah, it is.
Go ahead.
So, you know, I'm a believer that you don't have the luxury of time. So whatever you need to do, you need to do it expeditiously. I mean, this process of evergreening of bad debt can't go on. And I think what the government and the RBI has done, it was absolutely critical. It was absolutely necessary. We needed to send out a message to the corporate houses that this government believes in integrity, this government believes in discipline, and therefore this was necessary. But having said that, whatever needs to be done extremely expeditiously. And my personal view is that we could have acted much quicker, much faster. It's been through a lot of processes, and I think the process of NCLT, etc., would be a time-taking process. And we need credit to flow in. We need credit to move out. And therefore, we need to think of much quicker and expeditious processes of actually ensuring that companies which require credit. That's number one. But number two is our ability of, and I think it's very important to say this, that we must encourage bankers to take far many more risks. And the Indian system must encourage bankers to take risks to support the right investors, number two. And number three, it's very critical that there's also a feeling that there's no poverty of funds, but there's a poverty of well-structured, good projects, which will give you returns over a long period of time. Mm. And therefore, there's a role which all of us need to play in government and everyone together, that is to ensure that projects are well-structured, they are de-risked, and when they are put out into the market, we ensure that they are well implemented and that there's predictability, consistency, and clarity of policy over a long period of time, so that infrastructure projects have assured returns over a long period of time. And this is very important, because we'll keep making the same mistakes otherwise. And I think it's important that the Kelka committee, which has talked much about what needs to be done in terms of risk allocation for PPP projects and infrastructure projects, because the game is about, I mean, India's dying for great infrastructure. Infrastructure can't be created by government. Government will keep putting in money as long as there's absence of private sector investment. The more you force government to put in money into this infrastructure, government will create shoddy infrastructure. And therefore, you need a high quality private sector investment into infrastructure. And you need world-class infrastructure. India has reached a stage of its growth where you can't afford second-class infrastructure. Sure. You need to create world-class infrastructure. And that's best created by private sector. And therefore, you need to ensure on a long-term basis that projects are well-structured, de-risked, put out into the market. And there is a huge onerous responsibility on the government also to ensure that there is predictability, consistency, and clarity of infrastructure policies over a long period of time, so that private sector is able to generate returns on this investment.
Okay. We've spoken about, go ahead.
If I can supplement, I have the mic. Sir. On the point of exports, one other thing that occurs to me is, I think we need to find out ways to strengthen our Exim. You find many delegations, business delegations who come into India trying to sell their goods and services are backed up by sufficiently bankrolled schemes. India and Indian Exim do not go out calling on global markets in a combined manner. And we often tend to look at Indian Exim as not a first recourse, but as a last recourse. Mm. So there is a capacity constraint in terms of capital that is being made available. The credit guarantee insurance schemes needs to be boosted up. And if that can be done, a portion of what Mr. Kant attributed, that India should step out, gets enabled.
Okay. My last round of questioning is, we've spoken about investments, bank cleanups, the third one, and the most important one I would take in, jobs. This is a ticking time bomb. If you're not going to be creating enough number of jobs for a young, rising population, then we're heading towards social upheaval. Shankar, maybe I'll start with you. What do you think government needs to do? What do you think private sector needs to do?
I think the fundamental point that all of us have to recognize is the skills required to be relevant for the next 10, 15 years is going to be very different than the skills required in the past 10, 15 years. Mm. Today, unfortunately, and since I come from an engineering company, let me talk about engineering as a case in point. Engineers are today produced as a degree. It's no more a discipline. You don't find as many doctors going and working in an investment bank or a media, but you find engineers, several of them migrating into areas other than core engineering. Mm. Why is that happening? Now, if you examine the career prospects that the country is able to provide and the opportunities alternate, there's a very clear preference to alternate opportunities. So we need to recreate the excitement about being engaged in core manufacturing. Now, India has come to a time, in my opinion, where we should get away from this me versus you attitude. The government and the industry should learn to work together. Both of us are actually believing the same theme, that India needs to actually blossom to its potential. Instead of trying to outguess each other as to who's doing more, who's doing less, I think if India, the Inc., let's say, and the industry and government is able to come together, skill India very rapidly, and that is something that is scalable. Now, some amount of responsibility the industry also has to take, because it's going to benefit from those skill sets.
Correct.
But a lot of push also needs to be done from the appropriate government to make sure that it is remunerative for people to get skilled in the areas.
Rashesh, on the question of jobs.
I think the problem of jobs is actually all over the world. I think in India, if you want to create jobs on a large scale, really, I think the three opportunities we have, the first is in housing, because housing is one area which can take a lot of unskilled workers also. I mean, unskilled, semi-skilled workers, and you can take them in a huge amount. Mm. And it also has spin-off effects on steel and cement and all other ancillary benefits. So I think housing is one area that could be a catalytic industry in terms of getting this job cycle started. The second, as Mr. Kant spoke about, is large-scale manufacturing, because that opportunity still exists in India, not just for the export market, but even for the Indian market. But large-scale manufacturing, which can have, you know, like electronic assembly. We use so many cell phones and electronic appliances. We don't need to import them. We can actually at least assemble them out here. So there are a lot of opportunities in that. And the third one is in self-employed entrepreneurs, because increasingly the global economy is becoming a gig economy. A lot of self-employed, we are seeing Uber drivers and all that. I think even if you look at the capital availability, usually self-employed people, it's hardest for them to get access to, you know, bank loans, and hardly ever anybody gives them money. So I think getting capital to the self-employed entrepreneurs, because they not only create jobs for themselves, but they'll create at least 3, 4, 5 other jobs.
Sure.
So I think these three categories can really take large amounts of people who will find jobs.
Shanti?
So I want to take the third point first. Mm. I think what we're not seeing is the amount of entrepreneurship that India has spawned in the last 2 to 3 years. A lot of it may be attached to the IT, digital, logistics, e-com, you know, the supplier network, etc. But there has been an enormous amount of entrepreneurship that India has spawned, right? So as Mr. Khan said, they are still very small units. You want to create jobs on a very large scale, it has to be in the manufacturing. The services sector so far had provided, was one of the largest employers, if you look at IT services, if you look at banking and financial services. But I think everybody is into, like we said, skilling and productivity. Both of that are resulting into slowdown to some extent. So I think it's got to be a combination of continuing to promote entrepreneurship through policy measures, providing seed and access to other capital for entrepreneurship, because India is very good at entrepreneurship and you can grow. And sectors, energizing sectors like manufacturing, and I'd say even agriculture. Even today, 60% of India is employed by agriculture.
Yep.
Rejuvenating, providing some new skills, techniques, etc., that can really rejuvenate the sector. And it is also closely linked to investment. I think as you see investment into large projects happening, employment will follow.
Mr. Khan, last word before I throw this open to the audience. What is the thinking within the government as far as the question of jobs is concerned?
Firstly, much of the debate on employment and jobs is based on the Labor Board Bureau statistics,
yeah,
which is a very incomplete picture. It just takes into account 1.4% of the enterprises, doesn't take into consideration many of the new generation jobs, doesn't take into consideration informal and jobs which are up to 20 people. And they were, this Labor Board Bureau statistics was initiated when the downturn in the Western economies happened. So it's totally a flawed statistics to my mind. If not flawed, it's incomplete. My view is that you know, actually there are completely new set of jobs which are getting created. I don't know how many of us are aware that Ola has actually created 650,000 new enterprises. I mean, they're not drivers, they're entrepreneurs, they own cars. Uber has created 450,000 new jobs. You know, I was quite surprised when the IIT Mumbai director told me that last year, out of the graduates who passed out, 37% of them either started their own startup or joined a startup. And you're seeing a completely new energy, vibrancy, and dynamism in our startup movement. So completely new kind of jobs are getting created. But having said that, I think it's very important to say that India must embrace technology. You know, whether we like it or not, artificial intelligence, manufacturing 4.0, all this is upon us. And we must embrace technology with all our might. And even if we do this, you know, states like Tamil Nadu, Gujarat, Maharashtra will embrace it. But there are vast areas of labor-intensive sectors, textiles, food processing. The whole of Eastern India is dying for, you know, I mean, you need massive investments in food processing, value-added chains. And so food processing, gems and jewelry, leather and footwear exports, these will remain labor-intensive sector. So these are critical. The third point I want to make is that in India, the problem is not about unemployment. The problem is about underpaid jobs and disguised unemployment. And therefore, you need people to move out of agriculture into other sectors. And therefore, I think it's there is a very important need for restructuring the system of governance in at least 7 states of India. And 201 districts which are holding India back. And unless and until you don't transform the 7 eastern states of India and 201 districts of India, which remain backward, it'll be very difficult for India. You can talk of any economics in St. Regis Hotel in Mumbai, but without 7 states and 201 districts of India being transformed, it'll not be possible for India to grow at 8 to 9 or 10% for 3-decade period. It's not feasible. And I think, therefore, in these states and these districts, good governance must become good politics. We are trying to do that by creating a sense of competition, ranking, naming and shaming them, building, you know, much like ease of doing business, where we rank states. We're ranking states on education, health, water management index, putting it out in public domain so that people then start voting for governance for states which are well performing. And we'll do this for district hospitals, for district schools, etc. It's very important. And the last point I want to make is that you can't have jobs
with in 21st century with 19th century institutions. You can't have a corrupt Medical Council of India trying to create jobs for hospitals, for doctors, for pharmacists, for nurses. And therefore, you need to, we've recommended the medical commission, which is non, which can't, where doctors can't select doctors themselves. You need radical changes in UGC and AICTE. You need new institutions to create jobs. I mean, you need to use the highest outflow of foreign exchange is because Indian students are going abroad to study in all third class universities. You go to some vague university in New Zealand, you find an Indian student. I mean, you need to create Oxford and Harvard's here, as the Prime Minister keeps saying, rather than sending out students all over. And once you start doing this, you'll create a vast number of new jobs. You'll open up new hospitals, you'll open up, you'll have new doctors, you'll have new nurses, you'll have new pharmacists, you'll have new teachers, all next generation people. But you can't do this with the present institutions. You need an institutional restructuring of India.